Welcome to the final episode of Panad with Mersey to Jersey. Thanks very much for joining us over these past 5 weeks. Pete and I have had a great time chatting to our guests, and we hope that you've been able to take something away from the chats that will help you with your preparations for Guernsey next year and Orkney in 3 years' time. If you haven't seen the videos, well, do go back and watch them, and don't forget to subscribe to this YouTube channel for any future videos. Do check out the description below as well for any of the links we mentioned throughout this episode. And for one final, last time, grab yourself a cuppa and enjoy. So for this final episode of Panad, unfortunately, I'm not joined by Pete due to work commitments, but I am joined by someone who is hoping to qualify to compete for GB at the Paralympics in Tokyo next year. So a massive Mersey to Jersey welcome to Ben Pritchard. I think it'd be a good place to start is sort of talking about your background. I mean, you're in para rowing now, but you know, you've not always been doing that. You had your horrific injury in 2016, but before that, not only did you cycle in triathlon, but also sailing when you were a kid. So how did you sort of start out in sport when you were a youngster?
That's a good question. How did I start in sport? Sailing was kind of the first sport that I started, and was when I kind of learned that competitive edge. Yeah. But I was always an active kid. I have two younger brothers, so I guess from the age of four, I always had a playmate. So, you know, we always did everything together. I played outside. My dad was a big believer of kids should be able to grow up outside and have fun outside. And, you know, we'd go for adventures with my dad. And my dad had an accident when he was working. So he retired when I was quite young. I was still in primary school, actually, when he retired. So we had basically a stay-at-home dad that enabled us to try a variety of different sports. And both my parents are very supportive and very competitive. So sport was always going to be on the curriculum or on the home agenda, you know, trying to find a sport for us to do. Now, being Welsh, you'd think that was rugby, but I had an eye operation when I was young, so I wasn't allowed to play rugby because of the contact element of that. And then I guess, you know, you look at cricket, you look at sailing and athletics, and then, sailing. I started sailing at the age of eight at the Mumbles Yacht Club, and that's my first foray into competitive sport. You know, I was part of the Welsh squad, which trained at Plasmen Eye, and then went on from there, went to toppers, lasers, 420s, 29ers. So then, you know, you start to grow up as a young boy, and you kind of want to be around your friends at weekends. You don't want to be going away every weekend. And I just turned sailing more into a hobby sport and started to really like my athletics, because I could do that in my own time after school or during school, and did cross country. And I guess that comes from not being able to play rugby. I spent a lot of my time running around the bottom fields in school, and then naturally you become better at that, or, you know, become fitter, and the more practice you do, the better you become. And my name was always first on the cross country team. So then you go from cross country, you join the athletics club, you try 1500 meters, 3k, 5k. And then I started to love my running. And I've always swam. My parents always had this thing that they wanted you to learn how to swim from a tiny age. You know, so I was in a swim club as well, swim Swansea, surf, sailed, always been around water. So I feel comfortable in water. And then I was talking to one of my biology teachers on the way to, she ran the cross country team, and we were just chatting, and she was like, "Oh, I've got the Ironman Wales at the weekend, you know." And I was like, "Oh, what's an Ironman?" You know, trying to learn about it. She says, "Oh, you'd actually be good at triathlon, because you already swim and you're a decent runner, so why not try a triathlon?" And at the time, triathlon wasn't as popular as it is now. It seems to be the in sport now, but it definitely wasn't then. You know, I had to dig around to try and find a local triathlon club, because there wasn't one in Swansea at the time. You know, there were a bunch of people doing it, but there wasn't an organised club per se. So I reached straight out to the Welsh squad, you know, and I just emailed the Welsh squad at 16 and said, "Look, you know, I'm interested in getting involved. I can't find a local club. What can I do?" So they put me in touch with a guy called Andy from the Welsh squad, who ran like the juniors, and he actually founded Celtic Tri. And then we got in touch, and he started training me, and it took 2 years then of learning the sport, you know, getting to a level where I could probably compete to then enter in competition. So that's kind of, in a very short snippet, the history of how I got into triathlon. And then I represented Great Britain at age group level and European Championships and the World Championships. And then I went to work, started working full-time hours, and then all of a sudden the time you can commit to training starts to come down. And you might still finish in the top 10 in your local triathlon, but when you're used to coming in the top three, it's a bit disheartening. And it was all due to the fact that I couldn't afford the same time to train it. And then coupled with a little calf niggle that I had, I just wasn't running the same times that I wanted to. So I kind of had to make a decision, which of the three sports did I want to focus on? But cycling was the one thing that would get me out of bed in the morning. I loved cycling. I loved the freedom element of it. You know, you could go out and explore for 6 hours on your bike and find a little quaint coffee shop and have a good coffee. And then at the weekend, you can really pedal to the metal and race, you know, and I loved it. And I joined a club in London called CC London, and they were a big part of me falling in love with the purity of cycling and converting me from a triathlete to just a cyclist. And, you know, I kind of didn't stray too far away from what I was good at. You know, if you look at the history, cross country I was good at, long distance swimming I was good at. So triathlon, it was always, you know, you're going as hard as you can for as long as you can across three disciplines. So cycling, I knew that I wouldn't be that good at road racing or that good at the sprint racing, but time trialing against the clock, that's something that I thought I'd be quite good at, you know. And I broke the 20-minute 10-mile, which is an achievement that I'm very proud of. And I broke the 50-minute 25-mile, also an achievement I'm really proud of. So I kind of was getting somewhere in cycling, you know. I was never going to be a full-time pro racing the Tour de France or, you know, even on one of the championship teams in the UK. You know, I wouldn't be on one of those teams, but I could be on a shot-back team and hold my own. And I was really, really starting to enjoy it. And then, unfortunately, I had an accident and spent 3 months in hospital going through rehab. But sport was there for me, you know, and sport is incredibly important to who I am. It's my makeup. It's where I feel most comfortable. It's where I have all my friends. My friends are spread out through my sporting social, you know, social networks. You know, how I'm here talking to you today is because my vice captain at Bangor Uni, Matt Rogers, his brother works for Disability Sport Wales, and he's put me in touch with you. You know, that has all come through playing sport or doing sport. So I'd be lost without sport. And when I first had my accident, I remember thinking, oh God, if I can't do sport, I'm going to really struggle to come to terms with this injury, you know. And I went to Stoke Mandeville Hospital, and really lucky that was the National Spinal Centre and also the birthplace of the Paralympic movement. And they place a huge emphasis on sport. And I got to try so many different sports there. It was great. And for 2 hours a week, we'd have a dedicated sports session in our diary. And you weren't disabled. It sounds stupid to say, but you weren't disabled when you went to those sports sessions. You were just with your mates having fun playing basketball because everyone there was in the same boat. You know, you all had your own stories. You all had your own injuries. You're all learning how to come to terms with your new life on wheels. But you all had a passion for sport and you're all having fun playing sport. And, you know, if you go back to when you're a kid in school, you know, your break times, lunchtime, you know, your 15-minute break, those were some great times because you were just playing and having fun with your mates. And that's what I kind of akin those sports sessions to in Stoke Mandeville. And here I am. If it wasn't for those sports sessions, I wouldn't have tried rowing. And I wouldn't be talking to you, hopefully going to the Paralympic Games next year. So sport, I owe sport a huge amount. So
yeah, it's incredible. And in fact, there's a video on your website, which I think I suggest anybody watching this to go and have a look at. I'll put the link in the description. A video of, you know, I Am Able showing, sort of talking about your history in sport and also about the accident and your progression since then. It's really an inspiring video, really, for anybody, you know, may suffer setbacks throughout their sporting career, no matter what the size, really. Now going to sort of after the accident and finding out that you couldn't continue with cycling, what was it, do you think, in your, you know, you mentioned about the love of sport and you wanting to keep that in. Do you think there's part of your personality that has sort of a determination, a drive that sort of forced you to not just sort of sit back and give up, but to get involved? Because it wasn't long before you were sort of rowing, was it? I mean, you had your accident in September, I think, wasn't it? And then only a few months later, you were proper involved with, you know, doing your para rowing.
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm lucky that I'm lucky and I'm smiling because my two youngest brothers are my enemies and my best friends. all in the same package, you know. Yeah. One moment I hate them, the next minute I couldn't be without them, you know. And I think that's all brotherly sibling, you know, relationships. But if it wasn't for those two boys, I wouldn't be as competitive as I am now. Mm. You know, I mean that in the nicest way possible, but, you know, it would be who can eat the dinner the fastest, who could run, who could stand on the edge of the sofa the fastest. You know, whenever we were growing up, everything was a competition. And because of that then, that breeds determination and that competitive element. And that's part of my makeup because of my two brothers, you know, and I love them for that. But even today, we still have competitions today, you know, where they try and beat my rowing times, you know, and it just makes me giggle because, you know, they're my best friends and everything. But then you take that stubbornness or determination that was bred into you as a kid or nurtured into you as a kid, and then you go to hospital. I was very lucky to go to Stoke Mandeville, and I mean that in the huge sense, because they put huge emphasis on sport and the benefit it has. By the time I left hospital, I'd found the sport I wanted to try or wanted to continue. Whereas a lot of people that are in my situation don't get the opportunity to try wheelchair fencing or wheelchair powerlifting or wheelchair swimming, you know, just para swimming or para rowing or basketball, rugby, fencing, hand cycling. You know, I literally tried so many different sports that by the time I left hospital, I was already maybe a year down the line to somebody else that's newly injured. You know, a newly injured patient leaves hospital and is like, okay, I need to find a local club that offers para sport of some kind. Whereas I left hospital already with that in place because I went to Stoke Mandeville. And I guess that's kind of, that was the start to this massive or meteoric rise that everyone keeps donning me with. But and I guess for me, it doesn't feel like such a quick rise because I train every day and I work hard every day. But then if you're an outsider looking in, 4 years isn't a long time.
Yeah.
But it feels like a long time when you sit on a rowing machine every day, you know? I guess I'm just lucky that I went to Stoke Mandeville and I was nurtured with a stubborn attitude, you know? And I am very stubborn. And we go back to when I was first injured. I spent 3 weeks kind of not knowing whether I'd walk again or whether, because I've got quite an interesting spinal injury. It's not quite clear cut. And then, the first 3 weeks, doctors were like, you might walk again. Oh, no, you won't walk again. You might walk again. Then they do a test and they'd be like, no, you won't walk again. And then it wasn't until I got to Stoke Mandeville Hospital, the spinal center, that they were definite that I wouldn't walk again. You know, they kind of said, no, you know, unfortunately, we don't think you're going to walk again. You know, they can't be certain. But that happened. And then I remember sitting down and they asked me to write 3 goals of what I wanted to achieve, or 4 goals from what I wanted to achieve from my time in hospital. So the first one on top of my list was get back into sport. So that shows you just how important sport was. It was above everything else, is get back into sport, because I knew that without sport, I wouldn't truly be happy. Now, I'm not saying that everyone that injured or suffers a disability needs sport, because that would be a lie. You know, people have different things that make them up and make them tick. But for me, sport is essential. So number one was sport. Number two was live independently. Number three, get back to family life. And number four was return to work. So that kind of gives you the order of how important sport was in my life. You can see that with the decision to focus on one sport rather than just continue being average at triathlon whilst working full time. I wanted to be good at a sport and good at work, you know, so I had to choose one sport rather than the three. And that's kind of, yeah, I guess. So you asked, where did I get that determination from? I guess it's just from an early age of constantly being in competition with your two younger brothers. I was also the runt of the litter, so that kind of puts it into perspective. I was always fighting my younger brothers to try and get the bigger plate of food. You know, they're both over 6 foot, both rugby players. So it was a great, and you know, I love my childhood and I love my upbringing. So I'm very fortunate.
So how did it feel to you, the sort of, when it was finally announced that the Olympics and Paralympics weren't going ahead, that it would hopefully, touch wood, will be happening next year? Did you sort of take that as a, great, I've got an extra year of training, you know, because you've only recently come into the sport anyway, I've got an extra year of training to prepare myself to get to the, you know, the top, or are you in a sort of boat of feeling, well, you know, I was actually feeling quite good for that next year, something could happen, I could feel differently. Where sort of were you on the postponement side?
Really good question. So there are two answers here, and they are both applicable. So we were in our final week of trials for selection when we got told to go home. And then I arrived home at 4:15, and at 6:15, I got told my auntie passed away. And then 2 days later, I found out the games had been postponed. So my initial emotional response was bad. You know, it hit me hard because I lost routine of going to training every day. I then lost a family member, and then I lost everything I was aiming for. You know, I quit my job to go full-time rowing to aim for those games. And I kind of, initially, it hit me hard. It took me about 3 weeks to even think about training again. And that might sound dramatic, but it was just so emotional for me. I just had to take some time to come back to it. And then your head starts to, you know, your heart stops taking over and your head kind of switches on and you kind of go, this is bigger than sport. You know, coronavirus is huge. And then you can understand the logic of why the games had to be postponed. Even when the decision was made, I understood why the decision was made, but my heart still hurt, you know, and that was a real difficult internal battle then. It's because your heart was telling you, oh, you wish the games were going ahead, but your head was telling you it was the right decision. So you kind of had this internal battle, which then didn't help with the fact that you were trying to grieve your loss of your family member and also the loss of everything you've been aiming for. And it took some time for rowing to then re-announce that the Paralympics were going to go, you know, be pushed a year, because at the time they just said they don't know what's going to happen, but they're not going to go on this year. And then I think by the time we had the news that the games were going to be postponed a year, I think I was in a period where I was back training and I was back working towards something. We didn't know what that was, but we were back working towards something. And my coaches did a really good job of, as soon as they knew the Paralympics were cancelled, they dialed down our training. Now, it was still hard and it was still worthwhile training, but they took all intensity off. And if you imagine a year which starts here and ends here for the games, you know, we had done all the winter mileage and got fitter and fitter and fitter and fitter and fitter. And now our training intensity comes down, but it starts to get sharper. You know, we start to do shorter, sharper pieces to be ready for race speed. And we were like here on the rise up when we got the Paralympic announcement. So rather than pushing us up to this kind of level, they've just dialed it down so we can maintain here to then hopefully next year, rather than starting at this point, we can start at this point and continue. Yeah. So they did a really good job of handling that situation. And, you know, you speak to other athletes across different sports, and I think our coaches actually hit the nail on the head. And we're very lucky that if you've got a rowing machine, it's very applicable to what happens on the water. Yeah, there are some differences, but ultimately it transfers straight across to our sport. Whereas I feel for the athletes like wheelchair basketball that haven't been able to get into a gym for months and months, or even martial arts, you know, my brother is a black belt in judo, you know, and he's not been able to get anywhere near throwing somebody around because of 2 meter social distancing, you know, and all of these kind of sports that need you to be within 2 meters of somebody or need you to have contact with a ball that you pass on to somebody else. I feel for them because they haven't been able to directly train for their sport, whereas I have. You know, and I was still training. When I say I lost all motivation to train, I guess I lost all motivation to sit on a rowing machine because I like going outside. So I'd rather go for a run with my partner than sit inside on a rowing machine, especially when we were having all that nice weather at the start of lockdown. But I am also incredibly grateful that I can train in my gym and do my sport, because rowing ultimately is rowing.
But
that's kind of where my head was at. You know, emotionally it was a really hard decision, but logically it was the right decision to make. So you could cognitively understand that it had to be postponed, but emotionally it took a while to get over. I think, you know, there's a knock-on impact of that, which is on a selfish scale, and this is going to sound so selfish coming across to everyone, but, you know, I had made decisions based on the Paralympics being last year. You know, I'd left my job with enough money in the bank that I could last a year. Mm. You know, I had enough savings that could tide me over for a year, but now it's got to tide me for 2 years. And also, me and my partner decided to get married next year after the Games.
Right, yeah.
It's a year then, hopefully, to save towards the wedding. And also, I want to be involved in the planning of the wedding, you know. Whereas as it stands now, I will be training for the Paralympics. I will hopefully get selected. I'll hopefully go to Tokyo. I will hopefully win a medal. And then 3 weeks later, or less than that, I think it's 10 days later, I'll be getting married to my beautiful fiance 10 days after the Paralympic final, you know. So I think there are decisions, you know, knock on the butterfly effect, you know, one decision has a massive impact on the rest of your life. And you know, I just giggle sometimes. I think, oh God, next year is going to be really stressful, you know, trying to plan a wedding and prep for the Paralympics and do everything. But luckily, my fiance is very organized and we've got a lot of things sorted as it is. So that's really good.
I mean, it could be an incredible 10 days for you, really, you know, if you hit the heights of the Paralympics and get, you know, medal and everything and then get married as well. I mean, it could be awesome. So, are you pretty much a year out now from Tokyo Paralympics, and also Ynys Môn competitors watching this will be just under a year out from the Island Games in Guernsey next year. So, what is looking now a year ahead? What are your sort of plans for the year? Do you have sort of different stages that you want to try and meet throughout the year to progress to get to?
Yeah, definitely. My biggest advice, the first thing I would say to those competitors is obviously with the uncertainty of coronavirus, you know, that is, we don't know what sporting events are going to go ahead next year. We don't know what's going to get cancelled. We don't know how the events are going to be run, whether they're going to have spectators, whether they're not, you know, all of those uncertainties, just park them because they're not in your control. Mm. You know, you have no control over those. So you just have to control the controllables. You just have to look after yourself, make sure you're training, make sure you're focused for next year. And that's kind of the process I'm going through at the moment, is trying to, whilst my head is trying to work out all the what ifs and hows, I've got to park that and just focus on me and my training, you know. And it's going to be a big thing, the Island Games. You know, you're not going there as part of your sport. You're going there as a team, and there's going to be lots of different sports there. So you just need to remember that you can only focus and what you can focus on, and that's you and your sport. You know, you are an expert in your sport, so focus on your sport. And for me now, going into Tokyo 2020 plus one, it's going to be, like I said, September to December, it's going to be putting those foundations in place that you know, the very small fitness gains you're going to make, about not pushing yourself too hard, because whilst it's only a year away, 12 months is a long time to be on that red line. So you kind of want to be, you know, easing yourself into the year, getting yourself up to fitness, because you've had a long time probably where you've not been competing or playing in sport or having the ability to train. So you want to kind of get back into it, make sure your body's mobile, not getting injuries, injury-free, so that when you hit January, you can start turning the screw. You know, you can start turning that screw and getting more and more pressure till about March. That's how I do it. You know, I start building up. March, then I hope to be at peak performance. And that might sound early, because I want to hit my peak performance for March to make sure I get selected to the Games. Yeah. You know, because I'm still in a selection battle. So I want to make sure I get selected in March. And then I'll have like a little dip in kind of effort and intensity to recover from that March spike, and then about turning that final screw then and everything towards the Games. Mm. So I guess for those guys that are going to the Island Games, which are, I think, a month earlier than
July, beginning of July next.
Yeah, so around a month earlier. So they want to kind of shift that. You know, they probably should already be starting that foundation layer now, you know, if they can, if they're able to train and able to get into their sporting environment. They want to start doing that, start building that foundation. And then probably just before Christmas, they want to start tuning that screw. I don't know when they get selected. You know, it depends on their individual sports, I guess. But up until their selection date, then they want to come off. And then they really want to give everything they've got for the last couple of months. And that's kind of, people will kind of panic train now because they go, oh my God, the Games are in a year's time. I've got to give it everything. But a year is a long time. You know, 365 days of an hour every day training, or 2-3 hours every day that's a long time where something could go wrong or you can get injured. So you just have to take it a little bit slower than you initially first think.
Well, I think we all wish you all the very best for first selection, and then fingers crossed for Tokyo plus one next year, that you know you can bring home the medal, not just for GB, but also really for Wales as well.
We're very proud Welshmen, so definitely.
But thank you very much for joining us today and talking to me about all your different experiences and giving your insight to Ynys Môn competitors. And yeah, thanks, and all the best for the rest of your training.
No problem. And if any guys have any questions, they're more than welcome to, you know, get in touch with me. I'm on Instagram or via my website. You know, just send a message and I'll happily answer any questions.
Yeah, I'll put that link in the description and do watch that video. And thanks very much, Ben.
Yeah, thank you very much, David. Thank you.